the Schell Lab Group. We study urban wildlife in a variety of ways under this 4C model. So we use cameras to document animals as they navigate the landscape. We use carcasses in order to understand the physiological and genetic constraints of these animals as they live in cities. We use collars to understand how individuals navigate these landscapes, their activity, their exploration, their boldness. And then, the final C, we use community reports to understand how people are interacting with wildlife across the urban environment and get a really good understanding of our biodiversity writ large.
I'm really interested in how animals use their unique sensory systems to perceive their environments and to make decisions that guide their behavior. I set up a camera and then I also set up some type of cognitive task or some type of like new foraging challenge for them. And then I film what they do when they encounter these challenges. Raccoons almost always will interact with the puzzle and usually they solve it. Whereas coyotes seem a bit more hesitant to interact with the puzzles, and skunks and opossums try really hard with the puzzles, but they haven't been as successful as raccoons yet. And then we get a lot of domestic cats as well. Oftentimes they'll just like go and sit right next to it and like hang out as a cat totally would.
I get to study urban wildlife without actually putting my hands on any live animal. And I do that through salvaging different parts of the animal, either from their body after they've been hit by cars, usually from roadkill. We get whiskers, ear snips, hair samples, and then also through scat, which the animals leave behind, and then I bring it back to the lab. And all of those different body parts can tell us a whole bunch of different stuff about diet, about relatedness, about social structures, about health and physiology.
In LA, I've been working with collar data from GPS collars that were on 20 coyotes between 2018 and 2021. I'm able to actually study whether their movement is predicted by societal factors and human infrastructure, along with the ecology that we typically look at for building movement models for animals. Things like median income, so wealth, things like pollution burden, things like roads, those are quite obvious. Typically, they can serve as barriers in cities, so big highways, especially in LA. But also, they can be these elements that animals will use to move around the landscape more easily when we're not on the roads. Long story short, we're seeing that those societal elements are just as, if not more important than the ecological components for predicting where our urban coyotes are gonna be. For the coyotes in the Bay Area, I've been working with San Francisco Animal Care and Control to understand their coyote sightings database, which goes back all the way to 2006. And community members can upload their sightings of coyotes or interactions they're having with coyotes. We're a lot more likely to see a lot more conflict reports coming from wealthier areas. And that's probably because of all the green spaces that are available, all the contact people are having in these wealthy areas with these animals that are living in these green spaces. We're kind of using that to be able to change some of the messaging or enhance the messaging that folks like SFACC or even Parks and Rec or even the Presidio give out to all the community members.
All of these animals we sometimes come into conflict with, or people have perceptions of them as being a pest or a nuisance, or they might even be afraid of them. So by showing them these videos and, you know, how they have these different personalities, how they're interacting with the puzzles, it really brings up a lot of like empathy and connection between people and the animals.
That essentially serves as a leverage point for us to all understand and interact with these species in a profound way, while at the same time getting data for us to understand how we start to save these natural spaces and regenerate the natural world.